Hey everybody, I'm Chris White with the American Battlefield Trust, and before you watch this Perryville video, we just want to point out that we did have some technical difficulties with our microphone equipment. We are aware of it. We've cleaned up the audio as much as possible, and we do apologize in advance, but there is some great content here. We hope that you'll enjoy it, and please ignore the bad audio and enjoy the great content with the American Battlefield Trust and our partners at Perryville.
Hello, everybody. It's actually hard for me to stand here and shoot video. And I find that when somebody else is speaking, I'm just gazing around at the beautiful scene around us. And here we are for our final main part. We're shooting actually more than a dozen videos here this day, but in several big parts, we're covering the Battle of Perryville, October 8th, 1862, largest battle ever fought in Kentucky. You're with the American Battlefield Trust. We have some special guests with us, and they're all cool and all preservationists. So I'm really happy. So what we've done on successive videos up to this point is brought the Confederates to the battlefield. We've shown the attack of Cheatham's division, followed by Patton Anderson's division. We've talked about how Simon Bolivar Buckner's division is coming up by the bottom house, and things are going well for the Confederates. They're paying the price, but they're driving the Union on almost all points, and they're all starting to come to a head here in an area behind me called the Slaughter Pen. Okay, so let's get into a little bit more detail. I'm not sure if I just covered a lot of what Stuart was going to do, but Colonel Sanders. By the way, Colonel Sanders, because we are both, as is Chris, Kentucky Colonels, an organization you might consider joining. If you are of high character, or the person you know who is a colonel thinks you are of high character, you can get that done.
It's the Honorable Order of Kentucky Colonels, which is a wonderful charitable organization across the state. But as Gary mentioned, we're standing here near the Slaughter Pen site. And by this point in the Battle of Perryville, the fight had been raging, you know, between 4 and 5 hours. You had Benjamin F. Cheatham's division was shoving back the Union left flank toward an area known as the Dixville Crossroads, which is a couple hundred yards in that direction. The same held true against the Union right flank as Confederate General Simon Bolivar Buckner's division shoved back troops toward the Russell House site, which is behind us. Now, at the Battle of Perryville, the Russell House is an important battlefield feature because it was the headquarters building of Union Major General Alexander McDowell McCook. Now, McCook commanded the 1st Corps at Perryville. He had roughly, you know, 18 to 20,000 men on the field here in his corps. There are actually two other corps present at Perryville. There was the Union 2nd Corps that was south of town, commanded by Thomas Crittenden, and then there was the Union 3rd Corps that was west of town, commanded by Charles C. Gilbert. Now, there was a strange atmospheric phenomenon here at Perryville. Now, even though there are roughly 75,000 Union troops here, and as McCook's corps was battling for their lives here in these fields for more than 4 hours, the Union troops that were south and west of town hardly heard any of the gunfire happening here. That's because there was an atmospheric phenomenon here called an acoustic shadow. Because of the terrain here, you see it's very rolling because of the wind direction. The sound of battle was literally blocked from those other Union troops' ears. You had basically, you know, close to 40,000 Union troops who were essentially out of the fight here at Perryville because of that. Now, Union General Don Carlos Buell, who's the Ohio-born Union commander here, was actually west of Perryville with Gilbert's corps. He had been sort of thrown off his horse earlier in the day, was injured. It was sort of seen sitting down in kind of a hollow, reading a book with his foot propped up as a lot of the battle was going on. Now, he heard a few scattered gunshots, and he actually sent an aide to say, tell those men to quit wasting that powder. That's how out of it he was. Well, as the Union Army collapsed back toward the Dixville Crossroads, and as Simon Bolivar Buckner's division massed artillery and began shelling the Russell House site, the Union troops began falling back. But finally, Buell sent in reinforcements to help the beleaguered corps of General McCook. There were two brigades, one commanded by Michael Gooding, another commanded by James Steedman, who poured into the Russell House site. Now, among those regiments was the 22nd Indiana Infantry Regiment. They were fairly inexperienced. They were led by Colonel Squire Keith. And Squire Keith sort of brought the men into this direction. And as the battle was unfolding, it began to get very dark. And they were shooting at Confederates who would have been behind me at that time. But the Bishop General, Leonidas Polk, who was second in command here at Perryville, was leading some troops back in this area behind me. And you notice the dark line of soldiers behind Chris. There's a road right behind you and a split rail fence. And by that road, the 22nd Indiana was set up there. Now, Leonidas Polk didn't realize who these troops were. He just saw a dark line to his front. His men said, well, they're shooting at us. He said, oh, no, I'm sorry to hear that we're, you know, getting friendly fire casualties. So Polk actually rode his horse up to the 22nd Indiana, not realizing he was coming upon an enemy regiment. When he got to the line of these troops, he ran into Colonel Keith, and the two men got so close, you know, their horses were next to each other, and Polk rides up to Colonel Keith, and he says, "I pray, sir, who are you? You're shooting at your own men." Colonel Keith said, "No, sorry, General, they're the enemy. I'm sure that they're enemy." Well, Polk says, "Well, sir, who are you?" And he said, "Well, I'm Colonel Squire Keith of the 22nd Indiana." And that's when Polk realized that he was behind enemy lines, that he was by himself, you know, facing an entire regiment of Union soldiers. Well, as soon as he found out who Keith was, Keith then looked sort of quizzically at Polk and says, "Well, who are you, sir?" Well, Polk later said that he would brazen it out. He said that he was wearing a dark blouse and an overcoat, just sort of hiding his uniform. So he said, "I'll soon show you who I am. Cease firing at once." And he rode his horse down the line of the 22nd Indiana, down this road that's behind Chris as he films, and he yelled for those Hoosiers to cease firing. He then spurred his horse, rode back around to his Brigadier General St. John R. Liddell's brigade, and he told Liddell, he said, "Every mother's son of them are Yankees. Open fire at once." Polk later said that 1,000 muskets blazed as one gun, and he said the slaughter that he saw here was the worst he'd ever seen during the entire Civil War. Now, the poor 22nd Indiana, who were again caught off guard, who stopped firing at Little's men, were torn apart, and they suffered nearly 70% casualties as a result of Polk's accidental reconnaissance. However, that's important because it really sort of meant that Polk lost his nerve here near the Dixville Crossroads. Even though his troops could have pressed forward, they may have pushed back these two fresh Union brigades. They essentially could have enveloped Alexander McCook's corps here at Perryville. But as night fell, as confusion reigned on the battlefield, as nightfall and black powder smoke swirled around, Polk halted the attack, and that's where the fighting ended for the day.
Well, that was great, Stuart. Thanks. You know, and just to do a few things, we're going to bring on Joni House in a second. But first of all, I wonder if you're forcing yourself to sort of reconsider Bishop Polk. You know, he might have seen a strong enemy line and everything, but at the moment when he was in a tough spot, there he is, pulling off the bluff, the ultimate bluff, riding along and actually talking to the enemy and getting them to preserve his own troops' life before heading back and really trying to, make things happen. A couple of things real quick. I want you to know that right behind Chris, right behind the camera, is the Russell House. That's right there, about 40 yards behind Chris. And maybe, I would say, up this road in this direction is the Dixville Crossroads, maybe 150 yards, 200 yards away. It's not that far away. The Southerners are very close to success. And before we tie that up, let's bring on Joni House again, because, Stuart said that the Indiana soldiers were sort of oriented like this along the road, but that's not what people said for a while, Joni.
No, as a matter of fact, we often thought that the 22nd Indiana was oriented more, there's a pond which you can't hardly see, but they were behind that pond stretching this way. Well, we found a succession or series of drop bullets a few years ago, and really that changed the way we thought about this. Of course, the 22nd Indiana, they got absolutely destroyed on this ridge right in front of me. And obviously, as they were trying to load and fire, they probably dropped a great many bullets. So we found a numerous amount of those dropped bullets in line orienting this way on this road. So really, that's kind of changed the entire perception of where we thought the 22nd Indiana was in its coordination with the Dixville Crossroads. And I think Stuart had not said, but he wanted to say that Colonel Squire Keith was killed in this field along with about 56% of his men. So they, without a doubt, took the largest casualties of the Battle of Perryville that day.
Yeah, and while we have you here, Joni, if I'm correct, the park has some items that belong to some of the people involved.
Yeah, I think the coolest thing that we got a few years ago was a wet or glass plate of Colonel Squire Keith. It came to us from a family member. It was very badly fractured. I think we showed that to you last time you were down here. Since then, we've taken it to a specialist in Cincinnati, and the Friends of Perryville had that completely restored and stabilized. So now it's in the collection, and it's totally restored and stabilized. So it's just great work.
Great. And one of the reasons you need to come to Perryville, see this battlefield, walk this battlefield. I trust no matter how good it looks on camera, it looks five times better in person. It is meaningful. You can get an idea of what the troops were really going through, okay? And speaking of that, so the Southerners pushed hard, and eventually the Union, overwhelming numbers, come push the Confederates back. What's it all mean? How did that impact the community later? Let's bring Stuart back on to really tie this up.
Yes, as Gary mentioned, the Confederates tried to shove both flanks of the Union Army fully back, tried to envelop them, but they ultimately failed because night fell and ended the battle. The fighting had raged here for nearly 5 hours. More than 7,500 men were killed and wounded in that fight. Now, at Perryville, there were only 300 people who lived in the town of Perryville at the time. The Union Army sort of slowly pursued Bragg out of Kentucky. The Battle of Perryville, even though it was a tactical Confederate victory, meaning they shoved both flanks back, they killed and wounded more men, it was ultimately a strategic defeat. They'd come into Kentucky expecting to hold the state for the Confederacy, expecting to gain tens of thousands of recruits, but all of that failed, and they ended up withdrawing back to Tennessee, essentially to protect Chattanooga. So when the armies left, what happened? Again, there were 300 inhabitants here who were left to bury the dead and heal up the wounded and take care of thousands of sick people. Every home, every barn, every shed, every stable, every church, every business in the community, essentially anything with a roof, became a field hospital to contend with these thousands of casualties. In addition, there were thousands of sick soldiers here who were sick from drinking polluted water, and hospitals were here for months and months after the battle. There were casualties who were recovering from wounds in Perryville, in Danville, in Harrodsburg, and surrounding communities, even as far as New Albany, Indiana, for months and months after the battle. We know that hospitals closed here nearly 8 months after the fight, and really, the community never recovered from the economic impact of this battle. It's very important in terms of its national significance, too. It kept Kentucky in Union hands for the remainder of the war. After the Battle of Perryville, sort of Confederate activity in the state became limited to cavalry raids and smaller sort of skirmishes. But, you know, Kentucky was a linchpin during the Civil War. It was a very important state and remained in Union hands following the Battle of Perryville.
Man, I think Stuart might have done this before. Okay, and Taylor's coming over here. If he has something to say, come on over here. If not, I'm about to do an outro. So walk up if you got something. It looks like he's walking up. Let's see. Perhaps your last view on this particular series of Taylor the Fighting Bishop Pope Bishop.
I just want to definitely tell you all, thank you all so much for those supporters and donators to the American Battlefield Trust. Without your all's help, you know, these legends over here couldn't come out here. If it hadn't been for those donors, for them to even, you know, support this trip, they couldn't have come out here. You know, for those donors who helped preserve this land where, you know, Squire Keith was unfortunately killed, you know, who knows what would have happened over here if it hadn't been for you all preserving this land. I just want to say thank you all so much.